First World War was supposed to end them all. So much death seems impossible to repeat. 516 living in Gravenhurst left to fight in the First World War. 54 never returned. Among the fallen was William Harold Muldrew, the son of Gravenhurst High School's first principal. He was killed at Vimy Ridge in 1917. Most who went to war from Gravenhurst entered the Canadian Forestry Corps. Wood was needed for railway ties and the strengthening of trenches, and they were skilled lumbermen. They were shipped out to England, Scotland, and France to cut down trees and haul logs. The First World War was supposed to end them all. But it was just the beginning. The people of Gravenhurst traveled to the First World War. The Second World War came to them. Built in 1897, the Minnewaska Hotel was converted into a tuberculosis sanatorium in 1908 and was in use until 1916. From 1940 to 1946, the building was used as a prisoner of war camp known as Camp Calidore or Camp 20. It was feared that if Germany invaded Great Britain, the prisoner of war interns could become a reinforcing army, so they were moved to Canada, a country of the British Army where there were few battles. Camp 20 was guarded by World War I veterans, including Rama First Nations, and its prisoners, who were mostly dedicated Nazis, were treated like they were on vacation. Interns were allowed to leave the camp as long as they signed papers promising to return. The German hockey team was allowed to play against other teams in the area. Camp 20 housed one of the largest libraries north of Toronto, and most prisoners took courses provided by UFT. There was a dance band, symphony, and orchestra that could be listened to on Sundays. The camp even had a bear and a monkey that interns could wrestle as a form of exercise. Prisoner of war interns at Camp 20 were also given jobs and small wages. They built steps and a lighthouse at Gull Lake Park, the former of which still stand, the latter of which does not. Prisoners could use their wages to buy chocolate, beer, and pets. They built gardens and barns at the camp, and by the end of the war were producing all of their own food. But despite their fair treatment, interns still attempted to escape. When recaptured, they were sentenced to only 28 days in the guardhouse. Some escapes were not well thought out. A German Federalist named Ulrich Steinhipper made 5 escape attempts at various prisoner of war camps before the end of the war, 2 of which were at Camp 20. Others were planned in detail. On December 8, 1942, prisoners distracted guards with a snowball fight while a group of 6 German officers escaped through a snow tunnel and a hole in the fence. With them was food, maps, winter clothing, first aid supplies, and 4 documents that identified them as Polish refugees. When they were discovered as missing, police, guards with dogs, and civilians began to search. 5 of the 6 were captured within 18 hours, though 3 had made it all the way to Barrie. But one prisoner was still missing. Lieutenant Siegfried Schmidt was a German pilot who spoke good English and spent most of his time in the library. A week after Schmidt's escape, a farmer near Brampton found clothing that looked like it came from Camp 20. The train tracks were nearby, so the Guelph police were notified and they searched the next train. They didn't find Schmidt, but the express agent said he'd seen a figure jump from the train and run across the tracks. A giant search was amassed, with people looking as far as Toronto for the lieutenant. 4 months later, Lieutenant Siegfried Schmidt was found in the attic of one of the Camp 20 buildings. He'd never even left the prison. On the other side of Gravenhurst was Little Norway. In April of 1940, German armed forces took over Norway, forcing the king, his family, and many soldiers to flee. Around 120 displaced soldiers and naval airmen were sent to the Royal Norwegian Air Force. They were sent to a training camp called Little Norway at the Toronto Islands. However, the Air Force quickly outgrew the islands and was relocated to the Muskoka Aerodrome, just outside of Gravenhurst, in 1942. Things were tense between Little Norway and Camp 20. Pranks were common. At one point, Norwegian pilots bombed interns with potatoes while they were swimming in the lake. On December 13, 1940, a Nomad aircraft collided with another plane in the middle of Lake Muskoka. The other plane was found soon after the crash, but the Nomad, carrying Peter Campbell and Theodore Bates, was lost in the lake. It was found 70 years later in 2010. The plane is now on display in the National Air Force Museum of Canada in Trenton, Ontario. It's one of two on display in all of North America. In 1945, there was a parade down the main streets of Gravenhurst to mark the end of the war. Camp 20 was emptied and sold to wealthy Jewish businessmen who created a summer camp for Jewish youth. A fire in November 1967 destroyed most of the property, and another on April 13, 1968 burned the rest. Little Norway was converted into the Muskoka Airport. Much of the evidence of war's effect on Gravenhurst has been washed or burned away. However, its impact will stay with veterans and their families for the rest of their lives and should be remembered by all. Legacy, legacy.